Welcome to the Stock Car Spectacle. I'm Nick Kinzel.
And I'm Mike Gamble.
So guys, unfortunately tonight Ian Georgeson is not going to be able to join us. He's not feeling well, so we hope you feel better soon, bud. And so what we're going to be doing here today, is going to be doing another edition of Kinzel's Classroom. I'm Professor Nick Kinzel, so saddle up, boys. Class is in session. So we just finished off a great weekend at the Texas Motor Speedway as one of the better Texas races we've seen in a good long time.
Absolutely. Other than the finish, which unfortunately we're probably not going to be able to do a race review, I would say overall this was, like you said, Nick, one of the better Texas races we've seen in a little while. Maybe I thought they overdid a little bit with the PJ1. Sometimes I think a little too much artificial kind of groove on the track, but nonetheless, it was a really exciting race.
Yeah, I mean, from what we've gotten in the past since Texas Motor Speedway got reconfigured in 2017, that was some of the best that we've seen. For those, again, who have never watched the Kinzel's Classroom before, now that I only have Mike with me today, I have a list of five drivers here, and pretty much I'm going to list off some facts about their weekend. Mike's going to give them a grade. I'm going to see if I agree or disagree with them. Yep. So here we go. First one I got on my list, this is the RCR organization, Richard Childress Race. They had their first 1-2 finish in 9 years for this organization. That's just absurd to think of. Oh, yeah. We had Austin Dillon winning the race. Tyler Reddick finished P2. RCR's kind of been strong all season. Like Tyler Reddick as a rookie has been putting together some good runs.
Absolutely.
And even Austin Dillon, he's been consistently in the top 15 all year. Goes to victory lane, gets his third career win. Mike? Yeah. Richard Childress Racing, how would you assess their weekend at Texas?
First and foremost, I just want to add one little tidbit. The pressure is on the gambler this week. When you're the only one in class, the teacher's watching, you can't get away with anything, boys and girls. I'm sure we've all been there. But got to give them A+, guys. I mean, what else can you really give these guys? Like you said, Nick, you know, they really have run well all year, but this is the first time they finished 1-2. I can't even remember the last time it even happened. It would have to be way back in the day.
Yeah, 9 years ago.
9 years ago. Wow. Yeah, Christ almighty. No, good for them, though. Again, you know, we can argue all day about, you know, how they got up there. You know, especially when it comes to how the track raced with, you know, clean air and the tires is not falling off at all. But at the end of the day, I got to give them an A+. They finished 1-2 for that kind of organization. That's top-notch stuff.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. What they did, they took the gamble. Everybody else put four tires on. They put, like, two tires on or whatever. But, hey, I mean, I can't really discredit them. They had to go through two or three different restarts, and Austin Dillon held his ground. And, yeah, it was an exciting finish, so good for the Richard Childress organization kind of bouncing back a little bit this year. Oh, yeah. Second on my list is a 32 of Corey LaJoie. So Corey LaJoie had a 16th place finish. Out to many top teams, that's not gonna be too flashy. But for a small team like Go Fast, this is his fifth top 20 finish of the season. It's just a small team continuing to improve.
Yeah. For me, guys, that's got to be an A- performance, or maybe even a solid A. I know giving out two A's in a row in this show is kind of rare, might be the route I have to go. People don't really understand how underfunded that team is. You know, they came under fire, this year so far with, the Trump 2020 car. You know, not going to elaborate too much on that because I don't like to get too much into the politics. We don't have to, but safe to say it was very controversial, and they really needed to take that sponsorship solely from a financial situation. Side note to add on, I will actually be sponsoring Corey LaJoie in a way, shape, or form this week with the Plan B sales car. I already found my name on the car, so pretty cool stuff. But yeah, they're really hurting for sponsorship. It's a really small team. They finish inside the top 20. That's a pretty big day.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, how far that Go Fast team has gone. I mean, yes, they're getting chassis from Stewart Haas Racing, but I was reading, like, one of their chassis wasn't even from Stewart Haas. It was from Greg Biffle's, like, 2010 chassis that they were running. Like, that's just ridiculous. A 10-year-old chassis.
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah, great finish for Corey. Hopes that he keeps it up. So, driver number three on the list is the 20 car of Eric Jones. He finished sixth. Eric Jones has been struggling all season long. Yeah. Like, these past couple weeks have not been kind to him. Lots of finishes outside the top 20. And everything, and yeah, he's struggling all season. He's currently out of the playoffs as we speak right now, and his future is unknown after 2020. He's kind of just getting overshadowed at Joe Gibbs Racing right now because Denny Hamlin's performing, Martin Truex is performing, Kyle Busch, he's starting to get there a little bit, but yeah, it seems like Eric Jones is just, he's struggling right now. He got his fourth top five finish of the season. But the thing about Aaron Jones is he might not finish some of these races, but he can quietly put together solid runs. Like, yeah. Not going to hear him on TV that much, but he'll just solidly move his way up there. But, yeah, sixth place finish for him.
Yeah, I'll use that in the day. The day itself, I'm going to give it a solid B. Again, we expect somebody in Joe Gibbs equipment to be running this well. We expect them to be up there and finishing. All of his teammates have done that or do that. Again, we've talked about Kyle Busch. This is just a crazy outlier season. 2020, go figure. He hasn't really been himself. But at the same time, that team is the one of the top teams in NASCAR, if not the very top team. We expect those cars to finish in the top 10 regularly and the top 5 regularly. We expect them to be up there, you know, competing for wins. So to finish 6 is a good day, but it's right within what they should be expecting to begin with. And for him to be struggling this much, not a good look with all this young talent coming through.
Yeah, exactly. Like, we still do not know what his future is like after 2020, and he's out of playoffs right now. I could almost willing to bet if Eric Jones does not make the playoffs this year, nice knowing you, kid.
Yeah, absolutely.
That would be my prediction right there. Absolutely. But yeah, I give him a solid D as well. A good day for the kid. He really needs it. He really needs to start putting some points together.
It's scary because there's cars with a fraction of the percentage of funding that he has ahead of him in the points right now.
Yep, absolutely. Number 4 on my list, one of our favorites on Stock Car Spectacle, that 43 car, Bubba Wallace. Yes, he had himself another good day in Texas. P14, he just continues to overachieve in this underfunded equipment.
Right. I'm going to give that a B+, almost an A-. And listen, you're going to hear P14, you're like, it's middle of the pack. It's not that great. But again, you're looking at the expectations for this team, where about that car should finish. Not only, go back and watch that race and look at how that car performed.
He ran as low as 31st in that
race. Yes. There were moments of that, if not the worst cars on the track. And they worked on it. They stuck with it. Turned a piece of garbage into a diamond for them, basically.
Pretty much. I mean, so, they had a new sponsor on the board with Cash App coming on with them, so they had to be impressed with that. And that's Bubba Wallace's 8th top 15 finish of the season, so he's consistent. He's in the playoff hunt right now, so he's keep putting together some good finishes. We'll see what happens. So the last guy I got on my list is William Byron. So the rest of Kenseth's classroom has gone pretty solid right now. It doesn't look like I'm going to be seeing any, but buddy, out of those 4 after class. But then we get to old Slick Bill Byron here, P37. This man is struggling crazy right now. No top 5s all season long. He does have 5 top 10s, but the other 3 Hendrick cars are performing well. Jimmy Johnson, Alex Bowman, Chase Elliott, they're all performing where they should be. So really the question is it time to panic? He's out of the playoffs currently. And we had a pretty good conversation in our group chat, for those who don't know, with the Foot of Lead Boys and Dalton Good, Dakota Rutledge, we like to call it the Dega Infield Trailer Park Boys. Yep. We had a pretty good conversation about this. So, yeah, time to panic for William Byron.
Absolutely time to panic. I'm giving this another F grade. Side note real fast, the Kinzel's classroom has gone just like a Ryan Blaney mile and a half race. We look really strong all the way through to the end, and the wheels just come off for some kind of fashion. But getting back to William Byron, it's one of those things where you're running for one of the premier teams in the sport with probably the greatest crew chief of all time.
Yeah.
Again, they've been, if there's anybody that's been bitten as much by the bad luck bug as Ryan Blaney, it might be William Byron. Seems like every time something can happen poorly for that team, it does. So there is that. But at the same time, at some point, you got to start putting some runs together. At some point, you got to put some top fives together. He didn't win last year, but he ran runner-up quite a bit. And that car looked strong, and he led laps last year. You're just not seeing him up there contending for whatever reason. I don't think they're going to get rid of him. I think that's such a big name, and they want to push young stars. And I do think at the end of the day, in his career, William Byron will be fine.
Yeah.
But it's just not happening this year.
Yeah, he's really not taking off where I thought he was going to be taking off. Yeah, like you said, after last year, leading laps, like there is at least 3 or 4 races he could have won last year. Didn't work out for him. But then, yeah, we come to this year.
Yeah.
Is this really struggling? And, yeah, with Chad Knaus, it's kind of almost getting unacceptable at this point for me, because you got the team, you got the car, you got the equipment to do it, and you have a 7-time champion calling the shots for you. It's just, I know he has bad luck, but hey, man, look at what shirt I'm wearing. I'm wearing a Daniel Hemric shirt. He is the author of bad luck. So, yeah.
It's just like you said, though, it's the thing that's scary to me about it is if you can't succeed in the 24 car for Hendrick Motorsports with Chad Knaus calling the shots,
right,
where can you succeed? And the crazy thing about it is he succeeded everywhere else. So right, that's what doesn't make any sense about it.
Well, what makes me wonder is whether or not they moved him up too quick, because he ran well in the trucks. He got duped of a championship down in the trucks because of that playoff system down yeah, there. Goes on, wins an Xfinity championship, and he jumps straight up to Cup. So, yeah. And yeah, he struggled his rookie year. Last year was good. Now we're kind of starting to see some rookie year numbers right now, but maybe that's just a debate. Maybe William Byron's a 22-year-old kid, so yeah, you can have that discussion. Did they bring him up too early?
Listen, my opinion on that is no, because he has had success up here, and there have been plenty of moments where he's proven why he does belong. This year has been crap for them for whatever number of reasons it might be, but I don't think it's because he's not ready for the Cup Series. There's something going on. Again, obviously, we're not privy to everything that happens with the team. There's just something going on there where they're not firing on all cylinders like they should be. I think, again, Chad Knaus is the best of all time. William Byron will be fine in the long run. But whatever's going on right now sure ain't working.
Yeah, it really doesn't help him either that he gets no practice, no qualifying or anything. We got the announcement that there's going to be no practice, no qualifying the rest of the season. So that's going to be interesting to see how that goes. But, yeah, William Byron, I'm I will be seeing you after class. So the streak continues.
Yeah, brand new member of the Breakfast Club. Yeah,
William Byron, the brand new member of the Kansas Class Breakfast Club. Mike, you got anything else to say before we get off the air here?
No, not really. Again, just like we said, guys, it was a pretty exciting race overall. I guess we'll just touch on really fast because we're probably not going to be able to do a race review without Ian, just the two of us being here. It was a pretty fun Texas race. We had everything kind of the sun going on. I was thoroughly entertained by it. So, yeah, moving on to Kansas this week, this Thursday, oddly enough. So see what happens there.
Yeah, honestly, it felt like an old Texas race for a moment there, watching the second half of that race. It was really good. But, yeah, guys, so that's going to do it for us. Class dismissed. So for the Stock Car Spectacle, I'm Nick Hensel.
I'm Mike Gamble.
And, guys, make sure to follow our good friend Patrick Cotto. He's got a great sports podcast, the Cotto's Mojo. Make sure to follow our friends at Ashland Heddens Racing. I do not know if they're going to be racing this weekend. And then also just make sure to check us out on YouTube. Make sure to check us out on all other podcast platforms. And, yeah, guys, we'll see you next time.